you, Cal. So this evening is, Cal sort of set it up. This is not I'm not planning for a conventional evening. This is going to be an oddball kind of a blend of fact and fiction, which is what my book is. And I thought it would be kind of fun to just go through the creative process that led to this book. I want to talk a little bit about where my curiosity took me in researching the book, and then I'm actually going to read you a selection from the chapter that deals with these images to show what my imagination did with that information, with that research that I pulled together. Briefly, since I assume most of you have the book's only been out a couple of weeks, most of you have probably not read it, I want to tell you a little bit what the book is about. It's called The Gargoyle Hunters. Its protagonist is 13-year-old Griffin Watts. The book takes place in the vividly crumbling New York City of 1974-1975. It's the period in the run-up to the financial crisis and the run-up to the famous Daily News headline, Ford to City, Drop Dead. And Griffin is, in the aftermath of a really nasty divorce between his parents, really only wants one thing, which is to forge some kind of relationship with his estranged father. And so he allows himself to be recruited into his estranged father's architectural salvage business. It's an illicit and quite dangerous architectural salvage business. And Griffin is very small and he's nimble, so his father sends him climbing around the tops of iconic skyscrapers like this one, the Woolworth Building, and unsung tenements all over town to literally steal the exuberantly expressive architectural sculptures off of the tops of buildings that were the kinds of sculptures that were put on buildings routinely in the late 19th and early 20th century. And the father is a kind of obsessive, he calls himself a preservationist, but he's in the moral gray area of thief as well. So I had sort of two main objectives with the book. I wanted to tell at the same time a very small, intimate story about fathers and sons. And I also wanted to tell a big story about the near death of New York City during the financial crisis. And once I realized that the book was going to be both those stories at once, I realized that the world of architectural salvage in 1970s New York, which is where I grew up, could be both a metaphor for the disintegration of the family in this book, but also a literal backdrop, a concrete backdrop where the story of the father and son could unfold. So this brings us to skyscrapers. Here we are in the Skyscraper Museum, so I want to talk about skyscrapers. And since this book is about fragmentation, it's about the fragmenting family and the fragmenting city of 1970s New York City, what building in 1970s was, in the 1970s, what building in New York City, skyscraper, was disintegrating right before our eyes? It was the Woolworth Building, which is here as well. This painting is very near and dear to me. This painting was done by my brother-in-law, Simeon Lagodich, from the loft that he shares with my sister, not very far from here in Tribeca. This is the Duane Street loft. And that's the Woolworth Building out their window. And I basically fell in love with the Woolworth Building from looking at it from this vantage point. In the early 90s or mid 90s, I worked, my sister and her husband have an antique frame restoration gallery where they restore 19th century gilded frames. And I worked while I was in graduate school in this loft restoring frames. And every day I would sort of take some time to kind of commune with this building. And if you look at it across the months and years and different seasons and different lights, it's really richly textured facade kind of changes moods, and it became almost a living character for me. I think of it almost as my version of Monet's haystacks. So later on, when I decided I wanted to write this book, The Gargoyle Hunters, about architectural salvage, I was determined, I was hell-bent, that I was going to write a scene in which the characters, the obsessive father and his more reluctant son, clamber around the top of the Woolworth Building to steal a gargoyle right off the face of the Woolworth Building. So this is actually in negative. It's supposed to be white with a black line drawing, black etching. This actually is the frontispiece of my book, and it's in its normal form is actually quite beautiful, but it's not an artwork. It's actually it's a technical manual. This came from a 1914 technical manual for contractors called Architectural Terracotta. And it indicated all the best practices of how to install terracotta into buildings. And this is 1914. The Woolworth Building was built in 1913, so it's very much what the technology was doing at that time. Now this guy up here, who's coming off, you can really see, he's just coming off the corner of the building. He's quite similar to the gargoyle that I ended up writing about. And the original version of this, the designer who did the frontispiece of my book simplified it and took a lot of the lines out. But in the original, you can actually see that there's a bronze rod running through this gargoyle. He's got a little, he's got a bronze rod to resist rusting, and he's got a nut and a washer right in his mouth, and the bronze rod goes back into the building and ties into the steel of the building, the structural steel. And this was exactly the kind of gargoyle I imagined that my characters would steal off the face of the building. Now, to research the scene's backdrop, and I actually will go back for a second, oops. To research the backdrop of where the scene would take place, I tried to learn as much as I could about the Woolworth Building. It's a work of fiction, but happens to be a real building, and I wanted to sort of learn about the topography on the top of the building, where these characters would actually be climbing around. And so I contacted a fellow named Tim Allenbrook, who's here today. I won't embarrass him by pointing out which fellow he is. And Tim worked on a rather amazing restoration that took place in the 70s that saved the facade of the Woolworth Building. And my goal, really, in talking to Tim, was to anchor my flights of fancy in fact. He was nice enough to give me lots of his time, and I interviewed him at length. And really, my fantasy here was that maybe he would have just one or two snapshots of the Woolworth Building during its restoration in the 70s, the period I was writing about, so that I could, as I say, anchor my imagination in fact and do this in an authoritative way. So I sort of sheepishly said to Tim, might you have taken a snapshot or two that I could look at? And Tim said, well, as a matter of fact, I have an entire PowerPoint presentation all about how we did the restoration in the 70s, and it's chock full of photos, and I would be happy to share it with you. So he made me the happiest novelist in the world at that point. And then he did a really wonderful thing. So he sort of fact-checked my imagination. I would come up with scenarios, and he walked my characters really around the top of the building. And then the other fellow, who also snuck in here earlier today, I saw right at the minute, who was also a key source, is Roy Suskin, who I joke owns the Woolworth Building, but he knows everything about the Woolworth Building. He has been sort of the point man for the Witkoff Group that bought the building in 1998, and he is swimming in 100 years of documents and 40,000 photos, and I know he helped Carol with a centennial exhibition that she did here on the Woolworth a few years ago. So let's just start here now at the beginning of, this is some of the things, let's start with the beginning of the Woolworth Building. The Woolworth Building, as many of you probably know, was built in 1913. It was the tallest building in the world at the time, 60 stories. There's some debate about how tall it really is, but let's call it 60 stories. And unlike now, when high rises go up and everybody bitches and moans about how damn tall they are on 57th Street and everything's too big, actually back then people were pretty excited by the accomplishment here. And people, when the building was inaugurated in 1913, people thronged Lower Broadway here and City Hall Park, and the building was inaugurated at night with dazzling showmanship. President Woodrow Wilson, sitting back in the White House, flipped a switch at night and illuminated at one time the entire Woolworth Building with 80,000 light bulbs, and it was all over the newspapers. It was a very exciting thing at that time. Now the building is known, famous not just for its height, obviously, but also for its terracotta. And terracotta is a fired clay. Its terracotta is very special because it's got this sort of soaring, neo-flamboyant, gothic verticality to it. And the architect, Cass Gilbert, really took great care with it. And he said that he chose terracotta as the facing for the building, for the facade, because he wanted to clothe it with beauty. He wanted to give the city, the great building it deserved. And it's my favorite building in New York, and I think he he succeeded at that. Terracotta, he was very fastidious about it. He had he stipulated that the drawings, it was done by the Atlantic Terracotta Company, and they did their manufacturing out in Perth Amboy, New Jersey. But he made sure that the drawings were happening in the next office over from him, so he could have his people kind of keep an eye on it. And he also picked the sculptor. Terracotta is made originally. He hired a very skilled sculptor named Alessio Ricci, who had trained as a sculptor in Florence and immigrated to the United States in the 1890s. And he or his people, Ricci's, they modeled in clay every inch really of the terracotta facade here. And then once that was dry, they make plaster molds from that. And then the terracotta is cast out of those molds. Now, as the thing about this terracotta, beautiful as it is, it's also often been as much of a curse as a blessing for the various owners of this building. It's beautiful, but it actually began to fail almost the moment it was put on the building, the terracotta did. And Roy Suskin tells me that he has come across a 1913 letter from Frank Woolworth, the owner of the Woolworth Corporation, to Cass Gilbert, the architect, within 6 months. The building has only been open 6 months, saying, hey, the terracotta is already cracking. What are we going to do about this? So that was that was right from the get-go. And by the end of the 20s, this is also what's key. Hold on. So the part that I am going to read to you today actually takes place up here in these tourelles. What is a tourelle? The crown of the building, the way I think of these tourelles here, there's one at each of the four corners of the building, and I think of them as the jewels of the Woolworth's crown. They are very beautiful. The image I was just showing you before is the close-up of them. But what's interesting about them that most people don't know is that three of them are purely ornamental. They're closed at the top. But one of them, the northeastern one, which means it's on the uptown tourelle, overlooking Broadway, is actually open at the top, and the reason for that is that it was a chimney. It was the tallest chimney in the world. It was a 700-foot chimney, and they burnt coal in the basement, and the coal would come out basically in the winter. 1,500 pounds of coal soot a day was blasting, being spewed forth all over this beautiful top of this building, and it was a hell of a mess. So by the end of the 20s, it was pretty much black on top. And the other thing I want to tell you about these tourelles, which is key to us, if you see little gargoyles there, is they had eight gargoyles on each of them. They're gargoyles around the building. But up at the top here, there were eight, so a total of 32 gargoyles here at the top of the building. And so, as I say, by the late 20s, it was quite dirty at the top. And they actually would employ these crazy workers to go around without any visible means of support. These guys are climbing around on this thing like monkeys to literally scrub. They're sort of buffing the top of the Woolworth Building. And these guys here are our gargoyles, which we will concern ourselves with later. And this, amazingly, there is actually a 1931 newsreel showing these guys cleaning the top of the Woolworth Building. Nerves of steel. And that's a Tourelle. They're sort of mugging a little bit, leaning over. That's a bosun's chair. Don't tell OSHA about this, okay? All right, don't try that at home. I'm certainly not going to. So that was 1931. This is the 1970s. This is one of a number of slides I'm going to show you from the 19 survey slides that they photos they took in the 1970s. Basically, as I said, by the 1930, the building was pretty filthy on top, and things just got worse from there. So in the intervening decades, a lot of bad things happened to the terracotta. But in a nutshell, water, one of the things that happened is water infiltrated the mortar joints. And water, as you know, it freezes, it gets, and this bad sort of cycle of freezing and thawing took place. And so the water would freeze and it would start to push on the terracotta, push it out in other directions. And then the moisture inside would then also began to corrode the steel underneath it. And steel, when it is rusted and corroded, expands to something like 7 times its normal size. So there were immense stresses on the outside of this building. As you can see, it was filthy. And there was also kind of pitting of the surface of the building. And there was, at this point, real danger of some of these pieces actually just falling off the building and clobbering someone on Broadway walking, you know, walking to the park or walking to work or something. So they employed some rather unusual protective, idiosyncratic protective measures to keep some of the objects from falling off the building. That is a gargoyle, and he's got a leash, you can see. He's wearing a copper leash that is pinned to the building there, bolted to the building. If he should, this vivid sky beast should fall loose of the building, that will keep him from killing somebody down below. And then there's also, let's see what we got here. So this is a Terrell, and you can see how absolutely filthy this was by the 1970s. And these photos, as I say, were part of the restoration survey. The facade was in desperate need of rescue by the 1970s, and a group called the Ehrenkrantz Group was hired by Woolworth, and that's who Tim worked for. And basically they saved the building. They did a survey of every inch of the building, and they concluded that there were 26,000 pieces of terracotta that were so completely shot they couldn't be repaired, they needed to be replaced. And they replaced them with precast concrete. The nastiest, well, I don't know if it's the nastiest, but one of the thorniest restoration problems were these Terrells, precisely because they were so encrusted with beautiful ornament. And here you can see them in, this would be the 70s, late 70s. I guess the black mesh is on there, I can't quite tell if it is. But here's the gargoyles around the side. And there's another shot of them here, horizontally. This actually is the chimney one I was telling you about, with the open top. And this is actually where the scene I'm going to read you takes place. What they did is they wrapped it up while they were cleaning and restoring the rest of the building. They wrapped it up in mesh, and this protective mesh for 2 years. And ultimately, they concluded that really the expertise was not there, and that basically modernism largely killed the terracotta industry. I mean, I don't think that's an overstatement. I mean, in 1932, Philip Johnson and Henry Russell Hitchcock had a famous show at the MoMA called The International Style. And their argument was, they had a whole chapter devoted to avoiding applied ornament to buildings. So this kind of thing had become anathema. The buildings, as you know, the international style buildings didn't have any applied ornament. They had no imprint of the individual. And so by the time this restoration was taking place, there really wasn't a lot of, the terracotta industry was in deep decline. And it was sort of concluded that it wasn't going to be possible or affordable to replace them with terracotta for a variety of reasons. One thing is that the technology at that point that they were using in terracotta did not allow for the intricate undercutting of some of these three-dimensional ornaments. So ultimately, what they did, and this will surprise you unless you've heard it before, is they stripped these 4 Terrells of their terracotta, at least the protruding elements, and they clad it in glorified aluminum siding. And this here, you can see actually from a distance, it doesn't look too bad. This is the very intricate terracotta, the original terracotta. And this is the aluminum siding, and this here also is the chimney I was talking about. And so from a distance, it doesn't look bad, but you can stand, if now that you know that this is aluminum siding, you could stand on Chamber Street or in City Hall Park and look up, and you can see that it does look different. The one little part of this that sort of breaks my heart is you see these little projecting, they look like giant aluminum toothpicks or 2x4s projecting from the building. That's where the gargoyles were. So what happened, there were 32 gargoyles up here, and they were replaced with these giant aluminum toothpicks, which sort of begs the question, what the hell happened to the gargoyle? And I asked Tim this question, and Tim said the last time he saw them, they were under lock and key in a 28th floor storeroom in the Woolworth Building under the control of the Woolworth Company. Except for one, which was awarded, was given to Tim by the project manager. I think it was mounted on a wooden base, just the head of it. Terracotta is cast in sections, so a gargoyle might have two or maybe even three sections. So Tim was given one of these, and there it is. That's it. I particularly like this image because of the tab can. It really sets the period. And Tim now has this in his house next to the, that keeps it by his fireplace, I think. And then a year later, this is around 1982, 1983, Tim said he also saw another one. There may be a diaspora of Woolworth gargoyles. There's more research to be done here if anyone in the audience wants to do it. Tim spotted another one in the at Urban Archaeology, which is an architectural salvage company that still exists. They actually have a place in Tribeca. And he said there was an $1,800 price tag on it. And that was the last I heard, that was the last I knew of any particular extant gargoyles from the top of the Woolworth Tower until I went to visit Roy Suskin a few months ago. And Roy, I hope you don't get mad at me for this next one. But Roy is a bit of a hoarder. And that's a good thing because he's actually kind of an historian of the and steward of all the documents and photos of the Woolworth Building. So I don't know if you've heard of the Collier brothers. Roy is maybe not at that level, but they might be comfortable in his office. So I visited Roy's office, and Roy has been incredibly generous to me in a variety of ways. He has the biggest computer screen I've ever seen. It's just the edge of it. And he has 40,000 photos of the Woolworth Building. And so he was there one time I was up there, and he was going through the photos to help me out with something. And my eye sort of wandered up to the ceiling, near the ceiling, and on a shelf right up to the top, near the top of the ceiling, near the top of the wall, sort of gazing forlornly up at the drop ceiling, it seemed to me, was another Woolworth. This particular gargoyle actually appeared in this museum, yeah. In the centennial. They did a wonderful centennial exhibition about the Woolworth Building in 2013, and that one was in it. So this sort of concludes the fact portion of the evening. I'm going to click it back to. Can we put it on the broad? Yep. I wanted to actually repeat that the last one of the slides, but I can scoot ahead. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to read you the section of the book, sections of it. It's a long, 30-page chapter or something. I'm not going to do that to you, but I'm going to. The one I want to show is this guy. So I'm going to read to you about a gargoyle quite similar to this one. And the context is that it's the mid-1970s. The scene takes place at a time when 31 of the 30, all the gargoyles have been stripped from these Tyrells. 31 of the 32 have been stripped except for one. And it's this one here on the open-topped one, the chimney, on the northeast. And there's one gargoyle hanging off the edge here over Broadway. And Griffin, 13-year-old Griffin's obsessive manic father, is hell-bent on getting up there and stealing that last gargoyle before the demolition contractors come in the morning to destroy it. And the only other thing you really need to know is that on the inside of this Tyrell here, there's a little bit of that aluminum siding has already been applied because they had put it there as a mock-up to see if it would work, and they concluded it would work. Then they took all the rest of the terracotta off, and they're about to be done with taking all the terracotta off except for that single gargoyle. And the other thing is that here there's scaffolding coming up to about 15 feet below the top of this Tyrell. And that's really all I need to tell you. I think I'm going to sit down to read this. I might even put on my glasses because I'm getting old and I need glasses. So actually, what has happened here, just one last thing, is poor Griffin has been hauled out of bed at 2 in the morning by his father, who has dragged him to the Woolworth Building. They've broken into the Woolworth Building. They've crawled out here onto the 53rd floor and walked along this ledge here, which is only about 18 inches wide. And the father is now, he's brought some supplies, and he is now opening up his duffel bag, and he has just handed Griffin a saw, a nasty looking saw, the likes of which, power saw, Griffin has never seen before. "This is a sawzall," Dad told me, firing it up. He had to raise his voice to be heard over its phlegmy growl. "Got a nice reciprocal blade on it." I'd never seen a tool like that. It was ferociously loud, with a serrated saw blade that went jigga 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 in and out. Dad motioned me to stand back, then went to town on the aluminum siding, the sawzall making horrible shrieking noises as it chewed through the sheet metal. "Footholds," he said simply when he was done, gesturing at the series of irregular jagged-edged holes he'd cut all the way up the aluminum flank of the Tourelle. "Only the best for my boy." I must have said me, because Dad immediately snapped, "Of course you, I weigh 195 pounds. You think you can belay me?" Up above us, vertical terracotta pinnacles ringed the top of the Tourelle shaft like the pointy parts that stick up around the periphery of a crown. Dad took a length of rope from his bag and, wearing work gloves, climbed far enough up the Tourelle's side to reach up and feed the rope's end around one of these pinnacles. He climbed down and tied the rope to the back of my belt, giving me a bit of a wedgie as he tugged the knot to test it. "Pretty good, I think," he said, handing me the gloves. "Up you go." Again, with that shooing motion of his hands. He'd gotten himself so worked up that I didn't dare protest. I knew how scary he could get when he thought you were standing in the way of something he wanted. Up I went. While Dad looped the rope around his back and bent his knees in a ready-for-anything stance, I began picking my way up the Tourelle, using the holes he'd cut in the aluminum as hand and footholds. What surprised me most when I pulled myself up to stand in the wind on the Tourelle's rim was that I was even more afraid of falling into that Tourelle than off it. Unlike its three purely ornamental siblings, which were closed on top, this Tourelle was open to allow coal smoke to escape. So I was essentially standing on the rim of an enormous defunct smokestack with an open grillwork cone rising above me. I'd always had a terror of falling into holes, and that's what the inside of that Tourelle was, a 700-foot deep hole. If I was clumsy enough to tumble in, my spindly body would plunge straight down to the basement furnace, arms wheeling. "I don't like all the abrasion that pinnacle is giving our rope," Dad called up to me. "You're going to need more mobility than that. Hang on a sec and let me see what equipment I can find down where they're working on the 27th floor. "Wait," I cried into the wind. But he was already gone, disappeared around the corner below where he either couldn't hear me or pretended he couldn't. He had left me again. I felt my testicles tighten up close to my crotch in fear, as if they wanted desperately to retreat clear up into my stomach. It was a sickening feeling. You never feel more alone than when someone was with you just a second ago. I made a point of not looking around while he was gone, instead crouching on the rim and hugging the pinnacle, which was sooty gray and cracked. I tried to imagine what Dad might be up to from moment to moment, breaking into a storeroom downstairs somewhere, poking around in a tool chest with his powerful hands, hurrying back to see me. Surely, if I concentrated hard enough on him, he would in turn think of me, and that would almost be like being together. When Dad came back, he was carrying a big oval object that rattled as he walked. He told me to untie the rope from my belt and feed the end down to him, still keeping the rope looped around the pinnacle. When I fished the rope back up, my catch was a big wooden pulley with a green box cutter duct taped to its side. "That's a pulley from one of the hanging scaffolds they're using to clean the facade," Dad said. "Got some other handy stuff too, but I'll send that up to you later." For now, I was to untie the pulley, drop the rope back down to him, and climb around the rim of the Tourelle to the gargoyle. When you've got a nice angle on it, just clip the pulley to the grillage above you and wait for me. I did as I was told. No longer tied to anything, no longer protected in any way, I gingerly made my way around the crumbly rim of the Terrell with the pulley under my right arm, stopping periodically to catch my breath and try to get my heartbeat to slow down. The wind was picking up, blowing across the open ring of the Terrell with a resonant, melancholy hum, a deeper, more haunting version of the sound made by a breath across the top of a Coke bottle. For a moment, I again imagined falling in and started to feel sickish. To distract myself and keep warm, I tucked my chin into my chest, blowing hot air into the front of my down jacket. The outside of the Terrell's shaft below me was still covered in black netting, with some weird exceptions. Every few feet, the top of the netting had been shredded. Peering down in those places, I saw a kind of terracotta stump, which I guessed was all that remained of the gargoyle that had once made its home there. It was easy to see what had gotten Dad so hopping mad. It did something to your stomach to see a violent absence up close like that. After passing two or three of these stumps, edging far around the Terrell toward the dark gulf above Broadway, I looked down to see this time not an absence, but a presence, a sharply defined, long-necked figure jutting from the wall with prickly alacrity. The creature's body strained against the taut black netting that covered it, and if I hadn't known what it was, I would have thought it was alive. You could feel the energy coming off it, and the more I peered down at it, the more details of its exotic body I could make out. Curled claws gripping the facade, muscular, distrustful haunches ready to spring, a spread of feathers that might have been wings, an arched back and tense, alert neck. All watchfulness and cold, coiled power. And then, something amusing, or so it seemed to me, something that cried out for closer inspection. But first, to free up my hands. The old wooden pulley had a kind of clip at the top. I stood up tall and attached it to a steel crosspiece on the grillwork above me, then untaped the green box cutter from its side. Crouching down again and releasing the blade with a thumb flick, I began to slash at the black netting that shrouded the gargoyle. It was satisfying to watch the mesh fall away, and when I laid bare the gargoyle's form, I saw that I'd been right to be amused, for the surging terracotta creature was wearing what appeared to be an improvised leash. Looped around his neck and running in a taut diagonal up to a bolt in the wall above him was a weathered, small-linked chain. Like this fellow here. So now I'm going to skip ahead. What happens here is Griffin's father appears on the scaffolding about 15 feet below Griffin. And at the point I'm going to pick up the story, the father is belaying Griffin. So he's holding one end of a rope that goes from the scaffolding down here. The scaffolding is sort of down here. And the rope goes all the way up to the top of this Terrell, the cone at the top, and it goes down and is tied to the back of the poor kid's belt. And first, the father on a rope, he sends up a circular saw that Griffin uses to saw around the outside of the gargoyle's neck. And then there's the bronze rod running through it. That's the only thing I'm now holding it onto the building, the bronze rod that I told you about. So to get the bronze rod off, he sends up another saw, which is this long sawzall I mentioned before. And Griffin needs to use that sawzall to cut the bronze rod. Let me actually stand up for this. I permitted myself a glance at my surroundings. The sky was a touch lighter. The city a tad less protective of its secrets. Griffin's hanging off the building at this point. The sky was a touch lighter. The city a tad less protective of its secrets. The bulky smudges of darkness downtown were beginning to resolve themselves into something like buildings. Now this sawzall is jerkier than the circular saw, Dad called up from the scaffold planking. So to get better leverage, you're going to want to lock the blade in the on position by hitting the little button above the trigger with your thumb. Then you're just going to ease the blade into that cut you've already made. When you're ready, just put a little extra pressure on that top handle with your left hand and guide the blade slowly down onto the rod. When you've cut all the way through, that chain leash should keep the gargoyle from falling very far. By the time I was comfortable with my angle and my balance, my head was tipped down so far that I could feel the blood thumping in my temples. Don't worry. Lean over as far as you need to, Dad said. I've got you. I eased the blade into the slot on the gargoyle's neck the way he'd told me, squeezed the trigger, and thumbed the blade lock. Right away, I could tell something was wrong. I'd forgotten you're supposed to turn on a saw before making contact with the thing you're cutting. And as soon as that crazy jigga-jigga blade started trying to jerk up and down, I realized it was fighting me and fighting the gargoyle too. The blade was jammed in that slot and it didn't like it. To try to loosen it, I leaned farther off the building and shoved down with my left hand, driving hard from my elbow. At first, the saw didn't dislodge, just struggled further, its motor growling, all that pugnacious, herky-jerky energy transferring not to the blade, but up through my hands and arms, causing me to shift my weight abruptly to keep from falling. Maybe that sudden movement bent the blade or jogged something loose or both, but for one quick moment, the sawzall seemed to move as it should, its blade sliding down into the slot, sawing rhythmically up and down, until I felt it jolt against the rod, felt it catch and stutter and then kick back toward me with startling violence, the butt of the saw handle smashing me in the shoulder and knocking me off balance. I was falling then, tumbling sideways right off the building, dropping the sawzall to throw my arms around the gargoyle's long neck, a lunge of desperation that seemed, remarkably, to stop my fall, until I felt that wonderful abrupt tug at my waist and realized that it was not the gargoyle, but Dad who was supporting me, holding strong at the other end of the rope that connected me to him. In that moment, practically strangling the gargoyle with my arms in my confusion of desperation and gratitude, I saw the sawzall dropping toward the scaffold beneath me, its jagged teeth sawing the air. It didn't hit Dad. It landed on the planking a couple of feet from him, but with its blade still pumping fiercely back and forth, it skittered wildly across the wood toward his ankles, forcing him to leap out of its path. There was no way he could have held on to that rope. I felt it go limp at my waist, felt the burden of my own weight grow suddenly enormous on the gargoyle. I gripped him tighter in my desperation, heaving my skinny chest farther up onto his skinny neck, which, to my amazement, remained attached to the building. Then, slowly, almost serenely, the skyline creature began dipping his head toward the street. There was a contemplativeness to his movement, a deliberation, until his neck snapped cleanly at the cut I'd made, the little chain leash yanked right out of the wall, and I was plummeting through the open air toward the street, hugging this useless, dragon-eared hunk of terracotta to my chest. And that, I think, is what you call a cliffhanger. Thank you. If anybody has any questions, I'd be happy to take some. And then there are people in this audience who know far more about this building than I do, so maybe they'll take some.
In the film, you saw that the scenes of the terracotta were a very dark material. Was that original?
No, I mean, you guys should fact check me, but I think that's a kind of tar or epoxy to seal the joints. I mean, they knew almost from the beginning that the water was getting in. And that might even have just been prophylactic, just to keep the water from getting in.
What happened was in 1930, when they cleaned the building, they saw all the joints had opened up, and they felt an elastic material would provide a better seal than if they put water in. So they basically put black tar on every single joint, which you can see when they're jumping around. And some of it remains to this day. So the idea was that it would waterproof and keep the water from coming into the joints, which were constantly, I guess, opening and closing.
And it would expand and contract as well, because of this.
Yeah, because the only thing they had at the time, they didn't have white cork or anything. They just basically took tar. And they may have also been stuffing oakum into the joints, because apparently that was the only thing they knew at the time.
That's how they used to seal boats going down the Colorado River in the joints, they would put oakum in them. Same idea.
Yeah. Some of it remains there to this day. just like a little black line across the parts of the building, but that was the point. They did that right after they cleaned the building for the first time, sometime in 1930.
said the water got in and possibly damaged the steel frame structure. And they redid the building, but they have to redo some of the structure.
I don't know if that, whether they did. They did.
Yes.
They did.
Particularly at the top of the tower, at the base of the pyramid, which lands squarely in the feather of the steel.
And the whole circumference around it, they had to replace it.
And then there were lots of building repairs.
And the shape of this roof would have allowed the water to collect down there. Isn't that why there was so much corrosion?
Well, how do they prevent the water from getting in now? I know there's those steel thing, aluminum panels, but what about the rest?
Roy is the man in charge of chasing those leaks, so.
How do we keep it out now? Basically, they assumed that joints had moved as much as they were going to move, so they now when the wind joint opens up and packed with water. On the vertical surfaces, they actually put pieces of lead that keep the water from going straight down into the joint. It only works on a flat surface, spacing horizontally. On the vertical surfaces, basically, every 5 years, you have to go around the building and try and seal them.
Could you talk a little bit about the inside? I just happened to be there the other day and I forgot how really gorgeous it is. It's sort of a Moorish style or
I'm not gonna
interior on the ground floor anyway.
It's sort of these guys know far more than I do. It's a it's kind of
the inside is a combination of Byzantine and Gothic revival. Various and sundry parts of Romanesque barrel walls, whatever else they decided was pretty. So it's not really a pure style in itself, but it's designed to look like Frank Woolworth and Cass Gilbert's idealized version of a church without religious symbols.
And it's got the cross shape like a transept, the way churches do.
We should mention that the copper piece on our ramp is a piece of the roof crest of the Woolworth Building that is on long-term loan from Roy.
Is that a gift of Roy's?
Mm-hmm.
It's a 99 and a half year loan. Have to bring it back after that for another nickel.
You have a lot more of these in the basement, don't you?
Yeah.
I've seen them.
And that's what they're using those to paddle the replacement pieces. Plus,
Fortunately, it's a lot lighter weight than the terracotta. It's hanging by two little guy wires on our MDF wall.
So what's the budget for our maintenance for that building in here?
Enough to buy one for.
Not the top apartment, which is going for $110 million. It's the top story. I was up there, I haven't been in the pinnacle yet, I'm hoping to sneak in. But I was in the model apartments, and they did do a rather beautiful job of the terracotta window. This is one of the few buildings that I know of where you can actually see the outside of the building from the inside, and I don't mean looking at another tower of a complex, but when you're in the apartments, the window surrounds, the terracotta window surrounds, which are sort of blue and green and yellow, they frame the window on the outside. So when you're inside, you can actually see them. It's absolutely gorgeous. And they did a really wonderful job. They have teams of two going up and down the side of the building on scaffolds to repair the terracotta that can't be, or to replace, rather, the terracotta. And now they're replacing them actually with terracotta, not with precast concrete.
There's a great video showing how they replace the terracotta window surrounds. Are they, you may know this, are they, also going to add the gargoyles to that, or like kind of redo them?
They ran out of money when they got to the horizon, so they're leaving that for future generations.
The best part.
The Terrells are like the ignored step siblings.
Because the residents can't see it from inside, except the top.
When it opened, there was an observation deck, and what other public spaces were at the top?
I don't know. Wasn't that it?
Other than at the top, other than the observatory, interior, like a souvenir shop. The idea was you came in, you got in the elevator, they took you up to the 54th floor, they left you there for a few minutes until you bought something, then they put you in a little round elevator, which would take you to the 58th floor, and then you could go out on the observatory. Then you go back in, and you wind up presumably in the lobby. So other than the lobby, the little, again, it was actually listed somewhere as the world's highest retail store. but that's all we know about it. And then the 58th floor. Beyond that, there was no other.
Well, it's an important point that the lobby was a very famous, is a very famous, well, it was a famous public space. When was it closed to the public? It's not, people can't get in there anymore.
We've
got to take Roy to lunch to get in there.
I guess around 2000. It was actually closed before 9/11. Mainly, despite being very beautiful, the lobby, not very wide and not that easy to walk around people. So three people come in the front door to stand there. The tenants actually can't get into the building, so it was, it's now accessible through guided tours, so this way you can be steered and scheduled so that they don't bang into everybody who's trying to actually get to work. And, so it actually is accessible.
So, I actually recommend the tour. I went on a tour before I met either of these two that Carol and Roy did, and it's fascinating. Take you down into the basement where there's a stream running through the basement, right, Lori?
I don't think they
did. They did.
Well, we did for our centennial tours, but the organized tours now, which you can, you know, make an appointment online, and they're rather expensive, have different lengths of tours, and that's the only way to access it. And they're run by the great granddaughter of Cass Gilbert.
Oh, really?
Has dedicated herself to building almost as much as Roy has.
Does your book focus on gargoyles on any other buildings in New York City?
Yeah, that it does. It's really a motif that runs through it. It's not the book is not all about gargoyles. The term gargoyle hunter, the gargoyles, as you may know, are technically they're water spouts in the shape of grotesque animals or humans, like they have on Notre Dame. But the title of the book is taken from a 1962 New York Herald Tribune article, which was called Gargoyle Hunting in New York. And it was using the term gargoyle as a catch-all for these really beautiful carvings and castings that were routinely put on buildings when they were put up in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. So yeah, there's all kinds of scenes in the book about the characters haunting demolition sites and breaking into brownstones where the people are gone for the weekend to actually, with crowbars, remove the carved keystone out of them. They do some nefarious things. We're gargoyle hunters from the 50s through the 70s, many of whom did really wonderful work actually preserving these sculptures for posterity. The characters in my book, however, occupy a moral gray area where it's the father of the protagonist imagines himself as some great preservationist. In some senses he is, but there's sort of the gray area of whether he's a preservationist or just a common thief, or maybe both.
Were any of the gargoyles functioning downspouts?
I'm sorry?
Were any of the gargoyles functioning downspouts?
On this building?
Building?
I don't think so. Were there one? They're all just decorative. I mean, what was interesting to me is that frontispiece of the book I showed you, this one, so this was the 1914 book called Architectural Terracotta Standard Construction. As I said, the designer for the frontispiece wanted to prettify it, so she took the words off, but this was kind of like a blueprint. And it actually said gargoyles in big letters right across. So the common, it wasn't just sort of the 1960s Herald Tribune calling them gargoyles. The common parlance, you know, even in the teens, the 19-teens, was for these things that were not, they were just purely ornamental, they were not functional like the originals. I think maybe that does it, right?
Do you have another book in the works that's architecturally themed?
I may. Mm-hmm. I have been very busy with press and so forth with the book, but that'll die down eventually. Yes, I have, the things I'm working on have to do with I'm thinking about cast iron in the mid-19th century. So around 1850, which is basically when it started to come in. And I was thinking about, well, I don't want to tell you too much, but that's yes. I guess the answer is yes, more than
so. And should we expect a movie on the Gargoyle Hunters?
I sure hope so. I have some fancy agent who's trying to sell the film rights, but if anybody wants them, they're still available.
Starring who, Brad Pitt?
Actually, I never believe anything about Hollywood, but he actually is said to be, he's a great enthusiast about architecture. I'd be happy to get him. I'm not sure he wants to do a movie about it.
I think Leonardo DiCaprio is supposed to be an architecture enthusiast.
He'd be terrific.
Well,
so, they're both great.
Yeah.
The father in this book is extremely, he does some horrible things, but he's extremely charismatic. He's one of those people in life who people are drawn to, even despite themselves. So I think one of these really handsome Hollywood actors would do a really good job.
Well, I think you need to buy a copy of the book so you find out what happens and just how charismatic everything is. But you've been very charismatic this evening, so thank you very much.
Thanks so much for coming.
I'm Carol Willis. I'm the founder, director, and curator of the museum. We've been here 14 years in our permanent home in Battery Park City. And I invite you after the talk or some other time to come back and look at this exhibition. We do two exhibitions a year in this space, changing, in the central spaces, changing shows. This one, which is about the last quarter of the 19th century and a time when there was a lot of decorative terracotta and a lot of animals animating facades, is called Ten and Taller. It looks at all the buildings that were 10 stories and taller from 1874, which is the first one, until 1900. So I hope you'll come back and look, and I hope you'll come to the museum often, maybe even become members, and return to this series, which is our monthly author's talk, which covers books that on a very wide range of subjects. But tonight is unique, or it's a first time, it's a premiere for a work of fiction, because normally we take books that are about New York City's history, skyscrapers worldwide, contemporary or historic, but they're always written by either historians or enthusiasts or architects who look at the city through a nonfiction lens, and like me, spend a lot of time trying to explain things to people rather than to evoke a world around emotions. Are my kind of objective take on the history of the skyscraper is something quite different than this. And this is by way of me confessing that I don't get out much. I don't read fiction very much. And I've only just dipped into the book so far, but it's really delightful to read. And so, and I have to say that even on vacations, I don't get to read that very much. I spent a whole lot of time in the late 19th century over the last 6 months. That means that tonight has a unique quality for one of the Skyscraper Museum's events, but we did manage to mediate between the explanations about history and the inspirations from history that John writes in this book. Oh my goodness, Roy Suskin, come down and sit down here. The building manager from the Woolworth Building spying on the evening. Yes, that's that one saved for you, very much. So the inspiration through the buildings and through the history is part of what you're going to see in the slideshow that we prevailed upon John to put together for this evening to explain the kind of backstory of his inspiration. And I know this only because I've seen some of the slides and they're enormously evocative and illustrative of the history of the building. So with that, let me introduce the person that you probably already know the biography of, and some of the autobiography is in here, John Freeman Gill, who is a writer of all sorts of of formats and media, but most particularly, and this is a long list, so longtime New York Times contributor. He has written for many short stories about New York. He's the architecture and real estate editor of Avenue Magazine, and he writes a column called Edifice Complex. His writings appeared in The Atlantic, New York Times Magazine, New York Observer, Washington Monthly, International Herald Tribune, Premier, New York Times Book Review, so all over the place. And he has lots of credentials from universities to read off, unless you want me to.
No.
So, okay, so but here he's going to talk about buildings and himself, I guess.
Great. Thank you.